in this talk is to show some of the issues that have pressed formal ethics to start to take a more active role and to induce engagement. So it's the other end of the scale from the technologies. This is where the people are concerned that they don't have their voices, and one of the instruments that we're talking about especially is how professional societies can articulate that. Classically, it's been a fairly static mode. There is a real move to make it an active one, and there are consequences. I'll now address a couple of things. The classical context of formal ethics statements is the document that you look at and don't read, that the organisations produce and pay no attention to, and changes but rarely. Professional organisations have tried to do a little better, but rather sporadically. The rates of revision of their ethical standards have been measured in decades rather than years. The rates of change are increasing. Generally, formal ethics are seen to be a corporate responsibility and are framed, if I may be cynical and describe the truth, to protect corporations by being able to assert what their corporate values are. In some strange way, management doesn't have a professional ethics in which it can be tested. It's not an accident. Professional society compliance processes have been comparatively static. Unofficial activities have quite often got professional societies involved in ethical problems with their members, but not visibly. It's not been an agenda item. ICT as a whole has generally been rather centralised, influenced heavily by managerial and financial criteria, and this has changed fundamentally over the last 20 years. I would say 30 years, but certainly over the last 20. So the change in environment in which the ethics have to be addressed. I'm just fighting the PC, which is one of my standard processes. The current context is there's a very wide range of organisations in ICT and it's no longer centralised. There's a huge early development small enterprise exercise that are then bought up by larger bodies. And this ecosystem is very substantial and it's global. You don't know whether somebody has started a new enterprise like Zendesk here is based here, London, Massachusetts, Venezuela, literally. You just don't know. As it happens, it's downtime. Outsourcing is one of the complements. It's dominant over centralization. All the pressures are for outsourcing. The general agenda is only do your core functions. And oddly enough, the core functions are financial. Near universal impacts of ICT, communications, is a central part. It's now universal. We no longer have the option of avoiding it. If you want to be a survivalist, even then you have trouble. The big change in terms of public interest is ICT-mediated service delivery. Centrelink was a particularly poor example. The New South Wales has come up with their service centre with a number of quite admirable initiatives. They don't get the same coverage, but they're starting to happen and they will accelerate. This is starting to put pressure on the individuals who create ICT to pay a little more attention where their work goes and what they choose to work on. It isn't only government that's doing this segmentation process. And of course, segmentation also means that the terms of reference within which you're working are very constrained. So you have even less agency than you would have done in a larger body. The withdrawal of personal contact is both in design and deployment. Well, it's questionable whether this is ethical or not, but it's certainly a social issue. But these are the current contexts, and we're all reacting to them in different ways. Now, if I could fight this PowerPoint thing, it'd go quicker.
Do you want to end?
No, I've just got to put the pointer in the
press.
So where do ICT professionals fit in now? Because once again, like Greg, I'm taking the point of view of the technologist. Do we fit in design, in the coding, in the delivery, in the evaluation, in the usage made of what they do? the distances between each major element in this supply chain, and we should regard it as a supply chain, and are very substantial. In the trucking industry, there is now a full chain responsibility for the drivers, and it goes right the way through to management. We don't have the equivalent, but the precedent is there. Each of those questions, Greg has addressed as an ICT standard under development. But we don't see this public discussion from politicians, or indeed from lawyers, which is a pity, because they have a lot to contribute, although usually after the fact. What are the pressure points? The pressure points are where the ethical problems are greatest. The first one is the lack of co-design. There are groups who have zero agency and are subscribed to co-design. One, good saving. Nothing for us without us is an agenda that is now beginning to be recognized by everybody as something they wish for. The elderly, and I'll take the unfortunate example of conflation with dementia and the elderly, which came earlier, quite unintentionally. But agency is not part of the discussions. The ethical discussions are about the service delivery to the caregivers. Well, I'm nearly 80. I'm part of the target audience. I think I'd like a voice. Agency is no longer part. This is an ethical problem. There's a wide range of dissatisfaction delivery in terms of website design, telephone options, etc. Why? There are major public impacts, because distancing now includes automated rule systems, not all properly encoded or evaluated, but that wasn't the term of reference of the people who wrote them. This is the central point. We need to have a look outside our space. They're not new, but this unthinking delivery certainly is. I put a couple of references from the 80s in there when I wrote about these issues. I haven't learned my lesson. I always find issues 20 years too early, and everybody's forgotten by the time they become hot. But this isn't actually that funny. Research often gives the lead time, which is then dissipated and not utilized. This isn't happening this time, and the IEEE is one of the bodies that is partly anticipating, and in fact, to an increasing amount, is anticipating. I'm really bad at this.
Should we get one hand?
It's just my coordination is the problem.
Okay. If you use the slideshow, you can just put it.
Do you want me to put in a slideshow for you?
No, it's all right.
Okay.
I'll learn.
Okay.
Now, what's changed since the late 1990s? Some of you were born by then. Some of you were functioning in professional areas by then. So there's a sort of clean division from those to whom the 90s is ancient history, for those of us who have difficulty thinking of it as a long time ago. Well, I've had to remind Oliver that there was a benchmark ACS-endorsed professional ethics study done by, coincidentally, the Charles Sturt University and the ACS task force.
Yeah, but it was last century.
thank you for reinforcing my point, Oliver. Let's have a quick look at what this covered. I don't expect you to read this, because I put it there so when you get the slides you can have a look. And that's all of it. Now, what are the lessons from that? Well, no issues of community or other impacts at all, no sense of pressures on ICT from management, an emphasis on intellectual property, surveillance only of people in the workplace, no emphasis on data, and this inward-looking professional ethics framing is now displaying many gaps. We learn a lot from what was not covered. I find it fascinating to listen to what people are not saying and then ask a question about it. I'm afraid it's given me a fearsome reputation for questioning. You should do the same. There are new issues. The new issues are ones that we've rehearsed, but they need to be clearly delineated. Mass data collection and abuse. Now, no, use is equally important, but we only hear about the abuse. Use of machine learning, and notice I've not said AI, AI is broader than machine learning, undermines explanations because it's dynamic. the dynamic nature we can handle by using human judgment. Humans are dynamic. Machine intelligence may be dynamic, but it's not accountable. This is a fundamental problem, and it's one that fits the areas of uncertainty between technology and community application that Greg highlighted. Security theater. Do I have to mention the name of the minister? Can you remember it? Would it be Dutton? The abuse of national security to overwhelm all privacy collateral impacts, objections, and also all clear accountability. And of those, the greatest of all is accountability, says I, misquoting the Bible. Personal virtue ethics is activating IC whistleblowers. Now, if you don't know what virtue ethics are, again, it's one of these historical things. It's more than 30 years old. It's a guy called Socrates. I don't know if any of you met him, but none of us have. It's about 2,000 years ago or so. Anyway, he also said living the good life was an important value.
Good life.
It's not formal ethics that you comply with. It is being able to live with yourself, if you like.
Mm.
Now, virtue ethics, I wrote a thesis on it recently, which is due out in the Journal of Information Ethics, and the reference is at the bottom. It says, yes, but this is the driver of whistleblowers. Whistleblowers are saying, I can't live with the way what I know about or I'm working with or I'm creating being used. How do we empower them? How do we empower them in an appropriate manner? Now we go back to 1999. See the gaps? Well, the data abuse areas, and notice I put ab in commas because there's a lot that's really valuable. ABS census failed. Census mandated trust undermined. This is a strike to the heart of our totally inadequate constitution. It's one of the few things in there. MyKey de-anonymisation, blithely ignored in a huge Victorian government detailed data release, readily re-anonymised. That isn't the problem, you might be surprised to hear me say. The problem is that they protested it was all legal. That is the problem. 700 million person record leaks now common. Now, as a matter of interest, how many of you can name a couple? Goodness me.
Experian,
Exodata, I can give you a dozen.
Yeah, they're lots.
And they're global. Political access and abuse of private medical records is a matter of public ministerial record. This is not theory. This is not paranoia. This is delivery. So why did we take the contracts to write a retread of my health record, which was almost identical to the British National Health Service system, but was thrown out because it was designed to be so? I'll leave you to fill in the little blank. How often does a professional in IT handle their own ethics when involved in design and implementation? Few of us have time to think about any more than the serious problems that the manager doesn't understand. But we now are beginning to be blamed for it. So maybe that'll get some action. So what's the new territory? The new territory that we need to address, and you'll be pleased to hear that Greg is listing some IT standards being developed in the area, is data linkage, biometrics, and adaptive data-driven decision making. Those three are a little bit more succinct than the long titles of the standards that Greg did. But they're just for the communication and reminder that we don't have ethical standards for. In each case, the IT professional encounters major potential ethical issues in both design and usage stages. What can professional ethics do to help? And the corporate ones aren't in that shop. So who's responsible? That's always the thing. Who do you blame? Well, privacy by design, formally adopted. Authorization for access and release. Why haven't the technologists gone for continuous monitoring, modification, correction, and recalls? We do it for cars. Why can't we do it for our systems? Decision processing impacts from design and misapplication failures. RoboDebt is a wonderful example that I'd have failed an undergraduate for design. Well, maybe that's the peak. That is an undergraduate who did design it. It was, after all, outsourced. Management and political parties in all but design. They don't work there. They're not interested. But IPC can apply standards. and there I refer you back to our keynote. Enterprise system designs that secretly transmit terabytes as a phone home. How many of you have heard of ExtraHop? ExtraHop does a gargantuan cloud service. And they've actually issued a security warning because it's so easy to get it off. That was issued a week or so ago. Very widely known. Well, oddly enough, the IT profession hasn't exactly advertised it, but perhaps we should. Why does it matter? If you say, why does it matter, the first response is what harms have been created. The lawyers are good at that. Ever since that nasty little sprig in a bottle, they've managed to get harms into virtually every area of OHS and everything else in order to make OHS a term of hatred by many workers because of the way it's overdone. Oh, yeah. It's really about trust. And you can't articulate trust in a mechanistic way. You can put mechanisms in place to engender trust, to support it, to reinforce it, but you can't create it. Without trust, institutional political credibility falls away, and with it, any of the procedures they claim to participate in. We are very close to the centre of ethical SOC with NAB, ANZ, all within arm's reach. And that's just talking about the ones that you hear about in world commissions. Distance uses of data and automated decision making, including machine learning and AI, and I am distinguishing the two, reduce accountability, and perhaps also public access to these applications. One of the areas, how many of you have heard of Turnitin? Right, Turnitin is a way of checking for plagiarism. Universities have two modes. One, clobber the bastards, and two, let them run in through it so they can find out if accidentally they've done it. Which university would you prefer to study with? Rhetorical question. I suggest you ask next time you do a degree. What do we do? Why don't we permit users to do live bullets test anonymously, say of Robodeck, without identification, so they understand and can get familiar with the system, which is one of the major problems of dealing with sentiment. Nobody's even suggested an idea of actually allowing the people with agency to interact. But you see, this lies outside technology, it lies outside design, it lies outside deployment, it sits squarely in political and management. We don't have ethics. Data's the new oil. It is the basis for fresh productivity. And it's not running smoothly. Let's just say that they removed all the additives. And the key additive is ethics and trust. Without ethics and trust, oil gums up the works. Okay, let's derive at trust. Professional ethics are, as earlier defined, to engender trust in the profession. And there are penal actions for failures. They're very weak, but they do exist. And they do have a little bit of effect. And sometimes they're used. But they're only within the club. Supporting actions to assist professionals in making ethical decisions and representations are needed. Subcontractors, small parts of other areas, other responsibility areas. Professional societies are the only bodies of sufficient scale to provide at least some mediated access. It's moved IT whistleblowers into a key public interest domain. Snowden, Boyle, Assange. If any of those go down, the trust levels will take a quantum leap downwards. Now, does it matter? Yes. In the last 10 years, trust in government has dropped from 71% to 40%. The same people who did this study say the trends are that it'll be less than 10% trust in 10 years if these trends continue. That is not a structure for a survivable society. We have a major role to play. If you haven't seen the references at the bottom, read them. They're quite harrowing, really. So what's my conclusion? I've taken this narrow slice, just as Greg did, I've taken this slice. IT professional ethics needs to move from a static matter of record to an active mode. because the environment is changing, the pressures on our members are changing, and the consequences on the community are becoming more and more apparent. Inevitably, this will involve greater IT standards development. The IEEE is addressing this, and DINTA is a way of looking at the next round. Equally evident, support for whistleblowers must come and become an active supportive role for Australian Computer Society, to make the local reference, the largest relevant body. Government will also need to take an active complementary governance role. Now I can say a little flash of hope on the horizon here. The House of Lords did an AI inquiry, and I was fortunate enough, one of my old colleagues is a Lord, I went to see him, and I got half an hour with the people who were going to administer it. And I was filled with hope. If you read the transcripts, you will also get that hope. When you read the government's response to the report, your eyebrows will lift, because they have actually put in place governance issues and institutions to address it. It's not that the report said it, it's that the government responded to it. And just for your encouragement, the reference is there.
Thanks, Marcus. Maybe we've got time for one question before the break, then.
I'm wanting to ask about the comment you made that trust can't be understood in a mechanistic way. Would you be able to elaborate on that?
Sorry?
The comment that you made that trust can't be understood in a mechanistic way, could you just elaborate on that or clarify it? Didn't quite understand.
Trust is constructed in a lot of ways. Trust is often interpreted from behaviour, sometimes from declared opinion, but it is most apparent when occurrences arise where trust is needed, because information and evidence isn't available. Trust is what you rely upon when that occurs. And in the complexity of ITC and the complexity of government, this is happening more and more. Trust is not the new oil, it's the new additive. It marks the difference between grit in the chain and making it work smoothly. Once administration was called the necessary sand in the cogs, now we've got to reverse it. That's why I use trust as a pivotal element.
Thank you. I'd just like to remind everybody that morning tea is held.